An estimated 20% of the refugees are Christian Arabs. This kind Lebanese priest, Father Shukri Surur, every night crowds some 275 of the sickest and neediest into his ancient monastery in Gaza. In the cells, the corridors, the cellar, so they at least will sleep safely under the protection of a roof. 40 years a priest in Jerusalem, he did not desert his people in their hour of distress. He borrowed seeds for them to plant and raise their own vegetables. The unyielding desert sand inside his monastery walls slowly became gardens supplying greens at least for the children. For their clothes, for spiritual consolation, for all that has enabled them to survive these dreary months, they have had to turn to Father Surur, whose name has become a symbol of hope to Christian and Muslim refugees alike. For these youngsters, Father Surur's words are a message of comfort, a promise that tomorrow will not be as bleak as today and yesterday. All through the barren Palestinian hills along the road leading to Arab Jerusalem and Bethlehem, one finds isolated refugee groups. Some of them hide deep in olive groves, which date back to biblical days. The population of the little town of Bethlehem has been swollen by 43,000 refugees who formerly lived in Jaffa, Haifa, and other cities to the north. The Church of the Nativity is but a short distance from two large refugee camps whose occupants are as poverty-stricken and helpless as those in desert camps. Many are families whose pride compelled them to seek their own salvation rather than turn to relief authorities for the assistance which all so badly need. With no work available, they have a heavy drain on the city's inhabitants and its economy. This is the Church of all nations. Not far from it is an outstanding example that the spirit of charity still lives. This building is the Dar el Tifl Orphanage for homeless Arab refugee children. For 300 years it had been the ancestral home of Miss Hussini, an Arab lady whose name is as renowned in the Near East as that of Father Surur's for her humanitarian activities on behalf of her stricken people. She converted her home into a temporary sanctuary for 125 boys and girls, both Muslim and Christian. And to them all, she's mother, father, teacher, and provider. One of Miss Husseini's first steps was to provide schooling for those whose education was interrupted. Like all little girls, they are quickly adaptable to schooling, eager to learn, quick in languages, including English. But Arabic is their native language, and its mastery is the first requirement. Such school essentials as books, blackboards, pencils, and paper long were unobtainable until Miss Husseini appealed to Arab governments for what they could spare. The boys are not as keen on schooling. Naturally, they would much prefer to work in the garden. Already at their tender age, they've learned that green vegetables are essential if they and their sister orphans are to grow strong. Of all the thousands of refugee boys, these few are the only ones who have the facilities and desire to play like normal youngsters. All these children were found wandering in the streets and hills a few weeks after the start of hostilities. Many of the first children found died from undernourishment and exposure. It was the self-appointed task of Miss Husseini to save as many as she could, which she did by selling her possessions in order to purchase food. From emaciated toddlers, owing to her care, they became perhaps the healthiest of all the refugee children. Many of their parents were killed in the fighting, and identification of the children has only been recently established. Some have brothers and sisters in other camps, but reunion is not possible under present conditions. With the innocence of youth, they don't grasp the full import of their plight. They know nothing of the 450,000 other children under the ages of 18 who sleep on sand, under tents, or tar paper or tin. You can see that this youngster is the pet of the orphanage. There are no toys for them to play with, so after all, children are the same the world over. They have to be kept amused. This one's just sleepy. It's time for his afternoon nap. In fact, it's time for everyone to nap. They sleep two to a cot, 30 or 40 to a room, but they have a roof over their heads and are a lot more secure than if they were sleeping in tents out in the desert. While the children sleep, the older women refugees have work to do. Dresses, shirts, trousers to make, not just for the tiny group at the orphanage, but for hundreds, thousands, yes, for hundreds of thousands of others less fortunate. They keep working as long as the cloth holds out. When it's gone, they go right on patching and altering until a new supply can be made available. Many a flour bag has done yeoman service as a little dress, and it's one that was highly prized by its owner. It's a never-ending job to keep a 250,000 children clothed and warm. By the very thought of the task of getting one dress or one suit for 250,000 children is a frightening one. It would be a big job to buy such a tremendous quantity, even if one had the money. But these patient people go about the task of making these things with their own meager resources. They have a feeling that someday, somehow, the world will take note of their plight and lend to that struggle some kind of helping hand to ease their back-breaking burdens. However, there is some satisfaction. A job is well rewarded when a child can shed his ragged garments for something new. Inside the walls of the old city of Jerusalem, the refugees labor feverishly in their tiny shops to fill other great needs. The younger apprentices learn quickly from the older men. A shop like this, for example, can now turn out 50 pair of shoes a month. It's only a drop in the bucket in view of the many who have no foot covering whatever, but nevertheless, it's a valuable drop. In the Near East, metal workers have always enjoyed prestige. However, these artisans are reduced to working in second-hand tin. That's all that's available. But their contribution is tin cups from which children can drink and enjoy their meager rations of milk. Skilled woodworkers are woefully handicapped by shortages of material. There's a tremendous need for any kind of furniture. It's a case of one for all for one. It was down this road that thousands of homeless ones traveled in search of a place of refuge. Along a path with many familiar names. Historical names. Jericho, site of Joshua City. A sign pointing to the Dead Sea, where many refugees live hundreds of feet below sea level. On past the Mount of Temptation, some 45,000 of them stopping exhausted to remain until this day in camps near the Jordan River.